All right. Well, hey, great to be back with you, everyone, for our generating income in your portfolio. My name is Mike Fairbourn with Schwab Coaching. Today, we're going to be talking about selling puts on a stock that you might want to own. There's a lot that goes into that. Some really cool details behind it as well. I look forward to diving into that with you today. Joining the chat by my friend Ben Watson. Folks, you can follow us both on X. There's my handle right there. Just Mike Fairbourn CS. Let's dive on into it and get started here. Great to have you all here today. Let's hit some disclosures to get going. Please keep in mind that options do carry a high level of risk. They're not suitable for all investors. There's some additional points listed here to be mindful of on that as well. Information here is for general information purposes only. Should not be considered an individualized recommendation. With that, some additional points. The paperMoney software application is for educational purposes only. Now, investing does involve risks, including the loss of principal. Please be mindful of that. As well as some other points listed here. You can see here, we've got past performance of any security strategies, not guarantee future results or success. Some additional points to note, too. There are risks associated with investing in dividend stocks, paying stocks, including but not limited to the risk that stocks may reduce or stop paying dividends. So please be mindful of each of those, folks. Okay, well, getting into it here, let's talk about our agenda quickly and just briefly here. What is income generation? The types of income generation, there are a few types that we cover in this class. One of those is selling options. We'll take a look at that in just a moment here. We have a number of examples to look at as well, but let's just pull up the next slide. This might look very familiar to many of you as we go through this. We've been talking the last few weeks about dividends, specifically cash dividends. There they are right there. There are REITs as well. Turn your attention, though, to options over here. We'll be looking specifically at short puts as a way to potentially purchase stock at a lower price. So buying a company lower than where it's at and also getting a premium on the side to do so. Is the way it can work out. So let's go ahead and take a look at that today as we dive into it. But first off, I wanted to take a look at the general markets here. Let me go ahead and just pull my screen up real quick. I'm going to slide that a bit higher. There we go. Oh, on its way, folks. Let's see. There we go. Okay. Just doing just some final adjustments here before we get started. But let's dive into the S&P 500 index, as you can see right now. Well, I have drawn a line across there. It's actually a level that I've tweeted about a couple of different times as well. That level at 4,800, as you can see, well, it's not our first time to that number, 4,800. It's kind of one of those big round numbers, too. Sometimes, you know, stocks might find resistance at a level where, you know, they were prior highs, for sure. But the one of the key things I really wanted to note is that if I scoot back even a little bit further, I'm going to actually move over to the left here. On my trade grid, just to kind of highlight, folks, this was the major prior high that we saw over here as well. So really, it's not just the first time we've been there on a short-term basis. But be careful because, you know, you've got kind of an indication of a short-term resistance level, not to mention longer-term over there too. So it doesn't mean that we can't break back up above that level, but it does mean that we are at resistance and we've been here before. So here is... In fact, I think if I just go to a daily, yep, let's do this right now. Let me clear this off. We'll go to a daily chart and right here, 2-year daily. I don't know. For me, it helps to go back a little bit further. I've actually got to go to a 3-year. Do I have a 3-year daily? I do not have one saved. There's a 3-year weekly. Good enough. A lot of times I do like to go back 3 to 5 years just to see if we're getting any additional support or resistance that kind of ties in to where we're at on a short-term chart. And I think that can be very, very helpful to do. It lets us know kind of the gravity of the resistance level that we're looking at. If we broke up above there, it could be a really interesting sign. But of course, we are still kind of just holding at that level, just kind of going sideways right now. Now, a couple of things to keep in mind. The VIX over here, the volatility index, I just sent a tweet out on this as well, but it's real close to this 14 level. You can see that this is not our first time up to 14. In fact, I'll zoom in right now, just off of the right-hand side to kind of highlight this here for you. But if you click here, I mean, excuse me, I'm clicking. But if you look over here, there are prior highs right through here. Let's count them. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, you know, we're looking over here, at least over since the last 3 months or so, it's the fourth time we've been to this level. Now, could that kind of facilitate a move in the S&P 500 higher if the, or excuse me, lower if the VIX breaks higher? A couple of things to consider here. With the VIX having higher levels, all else equal, do we make higher premiums or lower premiums on the options that we sell? All else being equal, that is, we would make higher premiums when the VIX is higher, the volatility index. Sometimes, you know, the VIX itself can translate into higher volatility on the individual securities. So just something to keep in mind there. We'll see how that does unfold. But if it does break higher, there's just a tendency, right, that inverse correlation for the markets. And my whole point is just to be mindful of this going forward. Just watch and see if the S&P 500 then holds at these prior support levels, folks, right through here. And that's really kind of, a lot of times it's like 100 points lower. There you go. There's 4,700. We're coming off of like 48. So right there, as you can see, would we break this level or could we also hold support there? That is the one of the key questions just to ask ourselves, right? How are we going to do at that particular level? And we'll just have to wait and see on that. But if the VIX breaks higher, does it push us lower there? Well, we'll find out pretty quick, potentially. So here, let's another thing too, the DXY or the dollar. When the dollar strengthens, it tends to weaken assets, generally speaking. What is an asset? Well, S&P 500 companies are assets. Gold is an asset. Commodities are assets. And by the way, the dollar and the VIX tend to trend in the same direction. So just be mindful of this. We are getting it, what appears to be, let's just line this up again. I'll scoot it over here a little bit. Yeah, there we go. This appears to be like a trend line break that you're seeing there. It's not a guarantee that the trend's going to continue higher, but sometimes when you do get a trend line break off, in this case, you know, from the left-hand side, pulling over to the right, we get that break. It can mean down the road, higher highs and higher lows on the dollar. And that's the strength we don't necessarily want to see, because that could be a further force to push market prices a little bit lower. So what we kind of can do today and what we've sort of designed is a way to talk about, maybe trying to enter trades at lower levels, maybe at key support points as well, and to capture a premium in the meantime. So I do teach a covered calls and short puts class on Monday. If you've noticed, we've missed a few Mondays this week, this month. This is, I think, our third Monday we've missed. So I haven't taught a lot of that class. Great thing is if I don't teach that class, I can teach some of the topics in this class, because it is a way to generate income. And so I'm looking to do that. So I want to just take a look at a couple of companies. I've got a few here to look at initially, big picture, and to break it down. But before I go there, I wanted to highlight this here for you. I am in the, let me just pull this over here. I've got to just drag one thing off my screen. There we go. And I'm going to get this all set up here. I've gone into the research center on Schwab.com. And on this research center, what I've highlighted here for you to see is just a quick screen that I did looking for dividend paying companies the next 7 days out in the S&P 500 that are increasing, and a reference point to their dividend yields. And so I think this is helpful, particularly for this class too. We do talk a lot about dividends, right? And so I wanted to bring this to your attention. We have 10 companies in the S&P 500, and we can get this data here. Remember, these are dividend growth stocks. So they have been growing the dividend. In fact, year over year, as you can see, there is a nice little screener, or I should say criteria, there's two screen in Schwab that's got increasing or decreasing. And now, of course, we'd want increasing. They have a tendency to increase their dividends. It may help facilitate further increases down the road. We'll see. We don't know, but that's a good sign. I've gone over here and I've just exported this to the CSV file just so you can see it. And I'm going to pull this up so you can see what we've got here. I'll make sure this is big enough so everybody can see too. Might as well just expand that. And there you go. So these are, you know, we've got 10 companies. These are the 10 companies. You got the dividend yield here. This is some of the criteria that is yielded, though, when you run the search. Increasing or decreasing dividends, it tells you what percent they have are increasing the dividend versus last year. And some of these are quite large. APA, obviously that's a big number. But then you get some in the single digits too. These are the dates you've got listed right here. This is all really helpful in terms of upcoming dividends. They're all, by the way, in the S&P 500. So that was part of the original scanning or screening criteria. Screening, it's a screener that we would do on the stock screener within Schwab.com, as you can see right here. So there you go. Upcoming dividends. I chose an index. So a little bit, maybe the companies that have been around a little bit longer, S&P 500 companies, but you can export these to a spreadsheet, and that is all very, very simple and straightforward to do right there, okay? But these are those dates. And by the way, too, just as a quick note, just like within the Thinkorswim platform, there's so much you can actually find. In fact, we go to the Market Watch tab and calendar, you can still pull those up with the dividends right there. So this is S&P 500 companies that pay a dividend. I'm going to knock out earnings. And what do you have? You have basically the list that I had posted here, but it doesn't have all of that criteria for the week that we're in. There they are. There's basically all the same companies, but some additional ones. The requirements we had was that they were raising the dividend. That's just a cool thing you can get from Schwab.com as you do that. So pretty good there. Let's do this. Let's dive on into our discussion here, our key point we were going to talk about, which is selling puts at lower levels to potentially be able to buy stock at a lower price, right? To get an assignment at a lower level. So I'm going to start off with a couple of different companies here first. And let's talk about this in detail as we go through this. So a couple things to note. Let's do it. Here is Starbucks. So a company I think many of you are, all of you, I'm sure you probably are familiar with this company. Starbucks has been down. In fact, for the last 1 year, from the left side of the chart to the right side of the chart, clear downward trend. We've been dipping, dipping, dipping here. If I just take a look at the weekly chart, though, it does show that Starbucks, you know, longer term has held up. Its price has held up. We were basically looking at this range right here coming down. Now, there may be some support right through here. Can you see if I draw a line through here? This might be an interesting level, and why we might also want to consider selling a put around a weekly support level. It can provide some really interesting information, possibly in terms of, hey, does it also establish a short-term support level over here to the right-hand side? By the way, just looking at it, if I'm going to go down here in my drawing tools, bottom right-hand corner, I can kind of see here too a little bit of a Fibonacci. I thought it would be close to the 50%. I think we're right near that 50%, depending upon where you draw that from. Some will actually draw this from the actual lows, like right here, to the actual highs right there. And I guess that even gets us closer to a 50%. But look at that. That 50% Fibonacci lines up pretty well. Now, it has been going down, and there's no guarantee we're going to be filled at this level. But maybe somewhere close to that 90 level, we could look at this for selling a put. Let me show you a couple of things. Here is 90, and there could be a tendency for it to drop a little bit further. The trend is down. But if we were to sell a put at 90, what could that mean for us? Well, it is a way to potentially accumulate the stock at 90 if we were to do that. So let's pull this over here to the right a little bit, get my drawing tools back up, and just kind of highlight briefly what a short put do for us. That is if we are selling the put at a particular level. Here is 90 right there. So here's 90. Prices have come on down and they're ticking down to this level. If we thought that potentially it might go below 90 and maybe hold down below there for a little bit, we could then get assigned shares of stock. Now, what does that look like? Let's go over here and highlight a couple of different things. If the price here were to let's go right here and say it dips down below 90 by expiration. Well, then there's a much higher likelihood. In fact, it's say quite likely for us to be assigned shares of stock. So if we were to sell one put contract, or just put minus one P up here, at that level, and the price of the stock does go below 90 by expiration, in terms of standard equity option contracts, we can look at here, one contract is equivalent to 100 shares. So we would then be, you know, on the hook for buying, if it was an assignment, stock at $90, at least 100 shares for every one standard option equity contract that we sell. Now, on the other side, if the stock were to just go sideways, and maybe it holds above 90, maybe it goes up above 90. In those cases, all else equal, more likely just for that option to expire worthless, and then we could just capture that premium. But that could be building up some income for us as well over a period of time. If we carried that on for a month, so a month goes by and we capture a credit, right? Because it doesn't go below 90 by expiration and we do not get assigned. Think about that for just a second. If that were to be the case, well, maybe for a few months, possibly a month or two, maybe whatever the case is, we could capture additional premium that could lower our total cost, would be one way to think about it, on a purchase on Starbucks around 90. If ultimately it does go below 90 and we get assigned, right, shares of stock. So a couple of different things to kind of consider here. Let's just take a look at this real quick over here on the trade tab, and I'll show you a few different things. I am looking at 31 days right here, and I'm seeing that that's a little bit difficult to see. So let me just bump this up. I'll go to very large right there on the chart. So there's 31 days left. It is a standard equity options contract, and you can see that right now because there is your 100. Okay, so that tells us right there, if we are selling one contract, it's equivalent to 100 shares of stock. We are over here on the put side, and there is our 90 right there. So let's just take a look at this right now. There is 90, so real close to $2. I'll just say maybe a mid price in there somewhere. It's approximately $2, okay? Approximately $2 in there at that level. So if you were to sell on the bid, you could get, well, there it is, possibly $2, or remember there's a multiplier here, $200. Let's go back to our chart now and kind of review what this might look like for us. So a couple of different things. In fact, oh, there's my pointer tool. Bingo. All right. So if the price of the stock were to go sideways, what does that mean? Well, it means, and if it doesn't go below our 90 level right down through here, if it holds up above, it goes up or it goes sideways, kind of bounces around, even it goes below, but might go back up. Or sideways through here. If it doesn't go below and close below 90, we could still be capturing per one contract, okay, one short put, $200, right, in the premium. Now, maybe our goal, though, is to actually purchase the stock because, well, it, by the way, it is an income-generating stock as well, that like we had looked at previously, some of these might be dividend growth stocks. The dividend might be growing, too. Okay, so those are the considerations. Instead of just buying right now at 92.70, maybe we could buy it at 90. And in the meantime, capture a premium as prices are deciding what they're going to do. Now, if that were to happen, what does this look like right now? Let's just say if we were to buy shares of stock right now, if it was during the market hour today, we buy 100 shares of stock. Well, we're buying it at about 92.70. Not quite $3 higher from 90, but getting close to it. If we sold a put at 90 and it goes below 90, let's say it goes just below 90 by expiration, well, we're able to buy it cheaper than what we've got right here. This is 92.70, so real close. I'm not going to say it's exactly, you know, it's not 93, but it's approximately 93. Let's round it up slightly here, just for the sake of our discussion here. Goes to 90. As we think it might do that, well, there's $3 right there. It's $3 cheaper. Plus, what was it on the call or on the put that we were selling? Go ahead and add in those additional $2. So that would be like one way to look at it in terms of a total cost. That's a $5 difference from where we're at right now. Now, one thing could happen though. What if the price of the stock just spikes higher? Well, we would miss the trade. Has it shown that tendency to do that right now? It hasn't, but there is an earnings announcement upcoming and it could happen there. So this is kind of a bullish to neutral strategy. And maybe on this particular trade, it might be a little bit more neutral than bullish, right? But remember, make no mistake about it. We're looking to, in this case, use short puts or sell a put to actually buy the stock. It doesn't mean that we can't capture a premium in the meantime. So those are kind of some of the scenarios to kind of consider there as we go through this. Let's go ahead and put that trade on right now, and we'll just look at it, see what we've got here. I just clicked on the bid. By the way, quick note too, I'm going to set this up so we can see what the volume looks like. You can see the volume on the underlying stock. This can really help to facilitate a better bid and ask spread between the bid and the ask over here on the put side too. Under the layout, I'm going to jump over here and I'm going to simply go under, let's see, volume and open interest. That's a good read. Look at the open interest on it. So there's a lot of volume activity on the open, on the contract right there. A little over 7,800, right? Contracts. Again, if we wanted to buy this back for any reason, hopefully that could help to, you know, that spread could still stay kind of tight and we'd be able to do so. So that is a consideration to look at. Also over here, if we come over here and look at the delta, you can see that the delta is about 34. So it's kind of in that range a lot of times that a lot of traders will look at between a 20 and 40 delta. All right. And remember, the delta can give us a read on in terms of a historical implied, you know, volatility or probability of the price of the stock going below 90 by expiration. So in the next 31 days, it's about a 34% chance of doing so. Again, delta also says that, you know, this 34 cents represents how much that option might increase, or in this case, I'm sorry, we're on the put side, decrease. It'd be an increase over here if we had a 34 delta on the call side. But it's based on the underlying stock going higher by, you know, if the stock goes up by $1, this contract would drop by 34 cents approximately because it's on the put side, right? It's a put that we're looking at. So, all right. So with that, let's go over here. Oh, let's actually place that trade. So let's, I just clicked on the bid side. I'm going to click on confirm and send, and let's read through this a little bit. So we've got it. Place we've got here. So the maximum credit right there, it is not showing a commission. So just be mindful of that. There is a buying power effect right now as it stands, about $2,500. And then it's got the max loss. Now, again, that max loss does include the price of the stock going to zero. So if, in fact, we did gain ownership and Starbucks went to zero, that's what that max loss would be. Okay, I'm going to send this on through right now, and we will add this into our group. We're not going to get a fill right now, but we will keep this in as a short put within our generating income portion of the monitor tab. Okay, so that is there. Any questions on that? Remember, this is the ultimate strategy. You know, let's say if we're looking at what a trader's looking to do or an investor, they're trying to pick up shares at 90 cheaper than where the price is at right now, because they still think it might slide a little bit more, but ultimately they're bullish on the stock. So if they want ownership on the stock, remember, there might be other considerations too. For example, I mean, what are the growth prospects of Starbucks look like? Are they okay with that? We looked at the weekly trend too. Don't want to miss that weekly trend, right? We did see that there maybe is a 50% Fibonacci there. There's some long-term support. There you go. By the way, some traders as well, some of them will actually buy stock and sell a put lower in case it goes lower. And that would be their way of kind of accumulating more shares if the price of the stock were to dip further down. Then maybe they want to buy one more time. If it goes sideways, they can still capture a premium if they don't get assigned as well. So there are a couple of things. Let me just take a quick look and see if we have any questions. It does have earnings, Scott. That's absolutely true. Yep, there are earnings coming up, and that's a key consideration. I mean, because what can happen at earnings? In fact, what I like to do is go back and just look at the prior trend of earnings and see what we've got In other words, okay, this was an earnings gap. How did the other earnings turn out, right? You've got an earnings move here. This was a gap down. This was a gap down too. So there are some other things to look at. There's no doubt about it. Looking over here too with me, notice that we have dividends over here, right in this range right here. So we were looking at 53 cents. And right here, we've got us we're still at 53, and this is 57 cents. So it is a dividend growth stock. In other words, they've grown, the dividends increased a little bit. One additional thing just to be mindful of too on this is that if the price of the stock did trade lower over here, okay, and it did dip, we would be able to get a better, all else being equal, a better dividend yield at 90 relative to 92.50. If we're getting, you know, let's say 57 cents right here, and we're looking at a year ahead, well, what is the yield right now? Let's go trade tab. It's about 2.46 is the dividend yield. And all I did to get that was go to the trade tab, click on my little drop down right there. There are so many little drop downs, but there it is right there, right under underlying. So real close to 2.5%. If I go over here though, and just look at that 90 level, right? There you go. What would that dividend yield be at 90 versus where it's at right now? Well, I can look ahead too. I'm going to do this just for now. It's not going to be an exact approach because we did get a dividend increase over here, right? It's a dividend growth stock. But if I said, like, if we are going out, see, it's 57 cents right here. So let's do 0.57. It does pay quarterly. So if we just said, you know, we get a year's worth or $2.28 in dividends, Starbucks may pay out in the future as long as that stays the same. You know, we can now divide that by a lower price, which would increase the dividend yield. I'm going to divide it by 90. So it's about 2.53%. We were about 2.46. The dividend increase helps us. Buying at a lower price helps us. And let's not forget too, what else are we getting over here, folks? What's one of the really cool things about selling options is the option premium. In this case, it was approximately $200 per contract too. So just keep that in mind. So there are some benefits if the stock doesn't just take off and run. Obviously, if the stock takes off and runs, it would have been better just to own the stock. It's not to say, though, let me back up for just a second. How many of you might have more than one way to enter a stock that you think could be bullish? I mean, I could think of one right here. Let's say you've got something at 90, but you wanted to buy a total of 200 shares of stock. So what we're going to do is we're going to sell, you know, this 100, or we're looking to buy maybe 100 at 90. Price of stock goes below there, we get assigned. Say if that unfolds that way. But we were also, you know, our total would be 200. But what if the stock begins to break out and we just misjudged it and it breaks up higher here? Clears maybe this high. Breaks a downward sloping trend line. It looks like it might trend higher into the future. Well, if you think about that, then, you know, somebody could maybe buy 100 here and try to buy more later. What happens down below? Well, you would capture the premium if it expires worthless as well. Instead of buying those 100 shares, you'd have your one contract that expires worthless, right? And that still could lower your total cost as a way to look at it. You'd still be, you know, $200 better. Higher, I could say, based on the scenario we just looked at too. So just some things to consider. There's not always just one approach to purchasing these. Obviously, there could be more, and there's more than just two, of course, as well. All right, well, that's one we've got there. Any questions on that? By the way, some people might look, you know, they might look at a stock that's breaking up higher. I mean, this is NVIDIA. I wasn't actually looking at NVIDIA as a purchase here, but it did break above 500. What if somebody was just expecting, hey, I missed this trade, but I think it might come back and I want to pick it up lower? Well, they could try to sell a put down below, let's say 500, right? Because they think the train might have already taken off, trains left the station, but maybe I could try if it comes back to 500, maybe we don't think it's going to go to 500, but maybe 525. It's a little bit different, but there you go. Look at that. I mean, I don't know, BJ, that thing has just, you know, I mean, it's been quite strong, hasn't it? It broke out of its range, but it was a long time at 500 right there, right? It's been flat. And then we just kind of broke out. But just kind of on a side note, this does pay a dividend. The yield's going to be incredibly small because it's 4 cents relative to 500 over here. But and what is that dividend yield? Might as well just pull it. 0.03%. Needless to say, I doubt people are in this for the dividends. More of a momentum play. But could something like this be used to generate income still on momentum type stocks? Yeah, it could be. In fact, if I just come over here and take a look at the trade tab, there's our 31-day out. Where is the, gosh, we still don't have enough here. The 25, let me just pull this down and we'll get a few more. Let's go to 10. No, I did it. Not enough. Sorry, I bent down a little bit. There we go. There we go. So it was at, that's a lot. 25 right there. So 525 is what I was looking at. That's $790 right there on the bid. Of course, it's a volatile stock, and that needs to be considered as well. Look over here, just the implied volatility, really quite high. I think in terms of the VIX at 14, this is substantially higher at 37. But just think, 525. If somebody was bullish to neutral, and maybe they thought a pullback, they wanted to try to pick up shares at 525, that could be the case. If it continues to go higher, at least maybe they could capture a premium that expires worthless, right? Holds above that strike price by expiration. So it doesn't always have to be the pullback. It could still be like a pullback to support. It could be a breakout trade too. You see how it's a little bit versatile there? Yeah, it broke the 500 and it did take off, but it was there for a little bit, wasn't it? BJ and others. I mean, well, let's see, we got close over here. This does tend to lead the way. Well, it did last time for a lot of the semiconductors. I'll throw them out here for you real quick. AMD. Breaking up, INTC. Okay, a little bit of a consolidation there. I was going to look really at some of the dividend payers, kind of build on that. So my next one I want to take a look at for you, another dividend growth stock. So they've been growing the dividend over a period of time, but Mondelez, if you're familiar with them, I'm sure you're familiar with some of their products, although they're not listed here. Some of their retail products. But as you can see over here, this is Mondelez. Now, again, there is value to looking at a weekly type chart. There can be. Just I have the grid set up so you can see that, yeah, it's been a pretty strong upward trend. You know, higher highs and higher lows right here. What do you see? Do you see it? Is that a higher low here? I would call it a higher low from here. Higher highs, higher lows. And there you go. Let's pull this. We'll take a look at HD here in just a second, or Home Depot. See what's going on with that. But here is the pullback to 72, close to 72.50. Do you see a bit of a upward trend? There's been a higher high, a higher low. We broke above those highs. We're kind of flattening out a little bit. Now we are in the midst of earnings season, so that's something to be mindful of. But and there's your expected earnings date right there. But if we were to go sideways through here for a period of time, maybe if it went sideways through earnings or we didn't, let's say there was some volatility that could be expected around earnings. There was a bit of a gap right there. That was to the upside. This earnings gap to the upside. This earnings gap to the upside. This earnings just ran up a little bit and then dipped and continued to run. So it's been historically, at least recently, fairly strong with earnings. But maybe somebody is fine at the 72.50. And they think that there might be some premium here that they could potentially bring in if the price of the stock closes below there or gets assigned below the strike price at expiration or even before expiration. But let's put it right. Let's look at this one a little bit closer to where the stock is trading at. Here's the trade tab. Here is our 72.50 right there. So implied volatility, 21.99. You say, maybe that's not too high. It's a lot higher than the VIX right now, broadly speaking, for the market. Well, I mean, it's relatively higher, right? So you are getting some of that premium still, on the pullback, the bid right there, 130 to 140. You've got volume on the underlying stock. It's a little over 6 million today. It's heavily traded. Let's click on this right now and take a look and see what we get. So $130. Again, what does that look like? All right, we're putting it really close to the money. I think the next one down wasn't nearly as, it drops all the way down to 60 cents if you go to the 70. So let's do this for now. We're looking at it. We think that maybe, just playing the role of a trader here, that it's going to go a little bit sideways right here along this range and maybe hold where there was some prior levels of support. Here is 7250 through here, 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 right through here, and all the way across here. We think that it could hold possibly at that level. We don't know, but this is going to give us a little bit of income in terms of the premium upon assignment here. Or if it breaks out, does not get assigned, we could still get that too, to get the premium. So, all right, still putting this on relatively bullish trades, though. We're putting these on bullish trades. Here's our 130. I'm going to do something sneaky here. I'm going to try to get the 130 and a little bit more. We can check it and see what happens in the morning, but about 135. So just kind of spreading that a little bit. There's not really much there, but that's just as a side note. You can try to get more out of it if you want to. I'm just raising that amount up, what I'm trying to capture in terms of the premium. It is a one contract here. Let's hit confirm, take a look and see what we've got. Okay, well, it's 135, buying power effect, $2,100. And there is your max loss again, representing if shares do get assigned and the stock does fall to zero. All right, we put that in as well. So we're going to track these. I did have another one I wanted to place, though, for you before we're done. So this is one that has seen some recent strength, DoorDash. Now, this one does not pay a dividend, but the volatility is a bit higher. This is a little bit, you know, it's somewhat, well, it's different from NVIDIA, but at the same time, higher highs, higher lows, breaking out above not 500, but 100 here. Sometimes these big round numbers can be interesting if you finally get above it. Sometimes you can hold support there. There's a tendency for this stock to have a little bit of support recently. And if somebody was looking to maybe pick up DoorDash because they may have missed this move, but they want to try to pick up shares at 100 by selling that put. Again, one of the coolest parts is the ability to capture that premium in the meantime. Let's go here. Pull it up right now. Here is your 30 days still. Look at this. Implied volatility is 53. So it's approaching $4 that you're getting at that 100. What does that do for us too? What does our total cost look like if we're close to 400? If we get assigned and the stock goes about, you know, around 100 or so, which is where generally our assignment, obviously at expiration, very likely to occur. We'd be buying 100 shares of stock per contract at that 100. But that approximate $4 premium, does it lower our potential total cost? What would our potential total cost be? I can't point to it exactly, folks. I'm trying. About 96. Okay. So that implied volatility is quite high, making the premium higher. Could be even higher too if the VIX, like we've shown earlier, breaks above the resistance. Keep that in mind, okay? But just look at that. See the difference right there? So there is a little bit of a buffer zone too that premium could help to account for right through there, right? Could help with the total cost. So that could be a consideration as well. I wanted to put a few of these on so we can track these and keep an eye on them. But just remember, that's where we're at. Of course, you know, you're not going to capture that premium, the full premium, until expiration. It's just a key point to note there. I'm actually too going to just raise this up a little bit and see if I can get it a little bit higher than where it's at right now. Do you see what I'm doing? I'm putting that that order in a little bit higher to see if potentially it could fill at a higher. Well, that's above where we're at. You know what? Forget it. I'm just going to do this. We'll put it back to the market order price. That's right. It was only a dime spread, even closing. Now, I did want to take a look at HD as our final one here. There we go. HD. Okay. So this is very similar because HD had broken above some highs. Let's just do a quick weekly check on that. See the highs right through there. Now that's bigger. Count the highs. 1, 2, 3 in that range, over through here, here, and here again. Look at the pullback here. Slight kind of a bull flag with a breakout as well. Okay, there we are. So a trader thinking that this might continue on higher, what could they do? Where they sell could really depend on what their expectations are for the stock. Do they think there's going to be a little bit of a pullback here? By the way, in some cases, do they just want to maybe just try to capture that premium because they think that it's going to be strong, but they don't want to buy stock in the 300 range? I mean, right off the top, and keep in mind, there is that, you know, possibility of assignment where, you know, that's what it is. For every, you know, one contract you sell, it'd be 100 shares of stock. So keep that risk in mind as well. But maybe they're just looking to capture a premium, maybe even at a lower level, let's say below the 340, maybe down towards where they think their support is down here. You could come up top here and take a look at that, scan it. Folks, we've just been using that February contract this whole time too. But if I pull down to that level, and there you go, right in here. Okay, so there's your 330 right there, about, you know, 90 cents or so, 330. Just below that range, a little bit below here too. We're referencing support levels that might help bolster the stock at that point and keep it above that level too. But this really is an interesting way to also generate potential income. So consider that. And remember, I do teach that class on Monday where I just teach about covered calls and short puts. Now, on Monday, I'm going to be teaching the option wheel strategy in that class. I encourage you to attend if you'd like. And that is sometimes if you get assigned a short put, you turn around, okay, and sell calls. And you just keep this income generation going by selling a rotation between short puts and short calls, or vice versa. If you get called away, you start off with short puts again. But I want to tap into that on Monday's class for you as well. So just keep that in mind. Okay. All right. So a lot to look at here. Hopefully you found this informative, folks. That's a goal always. And by the way, always love to have you over here signing in or following us here. I'm just going to go right to our channel. Here are our coaches here. But if you go here, I'm going to put this in the links right now, just so you have it. But there is a subscribe button right here. Just click on that link and hit subscribe. Real easy to do. You get this great content coming up for you, within YouTube. And if you like this presentation, smash the like button. That will help the YouTube algorithm actually help force it to provide our content for you more regularly. If you like the class, here is just a look at my Twitter handle. I'm going to throw that in as well. As I mentioned, Ben's got one. Encourage you to click on Ben's Twitter handle too and follow Ben. But I'll just post that into the chat. And I do post content in here related to financial as well as charts. So just be mindful of that. But that is there. Hope you gained some insight in terms of some of these trades. We did place a few trades today, at least three. Within there, focusing on those options again. Come Monday, I will look forward to the option wheel where we're going to be incorporating a couple of these, and we'll have some examples, three or four examples to discuss as we go through that with you. All right. Well, it is good to be back with you. We did look at some examples. Just want to finish up here today. If we're all good on the question front, always happy to try to address those questions. And thank you, Ben, so much. It was good to be here with all of you. Yeah, thank you, Eddie. James, Jody, Scott, BJ, Helen, Mike, great to have you all here today, as well as others that joined previously, Bob, Rocky, Wiley, Bridget, and others too, Robert Boucher too. All right, everybody. Well, today's content was intended for educational information purposes only. I look forward to future discussions with you all. Have a great rest of the day.